Good evening, this is Pastor Dominique from Evander Revival Center. Welcome to this live broadcast where I'll be sharing the Word of God with you. Now, do you need breakthrough in your health? Are you struggling to receive healing? Maybe you're despondent because you've gone to somebody for prayer and you haven't seen a manifestation of healing. The word that I have tonight is for you. This word's going to encourage you and it's going to help you tremendously. And I'm going to show you according to the scripture that God's word is healing. It is medicine for our flesh. And I want you to be encouraged tonight and not to forfeit your miracle, but to believe that your miracle will still take place. Now, tonight I'm in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 8. And I'll be reading from verse 1 to verse 9. That's Matthew chapter 8, verse 1 to verse 9. Listen to what the Bible says. And when he, Jesus, had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, See that you tell no one, but go your way, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed and dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. I want to focus on verse 8. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. One thing we've got to understand about the Bible is that when the Bible was originally written, it wasn't written with chapters and verses. It was written as one continuous story. So if you had to read the Gospel of Matthew, you wouldn't have read chapters and verses. You would have read one story as Matthew was presenting to the Jews the Messiah, which is Jesus Christ. Now, what preceded this chapter, it's crucial to understand because in Matthew chapter 7, verse 28 to 29, it says, listen to this. These are the verses before Matthew chapter 8. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching. For he taught them as one having authority, not as the scribes. Jesus had just concluded what was the greatest sermon ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount. It's the greatest sermon that you can find in the Bible. Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 7. Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount. And when he concluded, the Bible says that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught as one who had authority. He was different from their religious teachers of the day. Now, what gave Jesus such authority? Quite simply, it was the anointing. Now, what is the anointing? Acts chapter 10 verse 38 says, Jesus was anointed by the Holy Spirit and he went about doing good and destroying the works of the enemy. Jesus was anointed by the Holy Spirit. He was anointed. In the Old Testament, to be anointed meant that you were anointed with oil, symbolic of the Holy Spirit coming upon you, and you would be set apart or consecrated for the work of the Lord. Exodus chapter 28 verse 41. Now as a priest or a king or a prophet was anointed with oil in the Old Testament, Jesus in the New Testament was anointed in the Spirit with the Holy Spirit. He was anointed with the Spirit of God. In fact, the name Christ means the anointed one. And we see even in the Old Testament, when the Holy Spirit came upon somebody, he came upon that person with power and anointing. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13. So, the anointing equals power, and the anointing produces authority. So you don't just have power, but you also have authority when you've got the anointing upon you. And that's what set Jesus apart in his day from other preachers, other teachers, from other rabbis, is the fact that he had the anointing. He had the Holy Spirit that was evident in his ministry. And that's what we need today. We need preachers that are filled with the Spirit of God. Now, there was a preacher that once told a story to illustrate the difference between somebody that's anointed and somebody that's eloquent in speech. He said one day a pastor got up and he preached from Psalm 23. And this pastor was quite accomplished in public speaking. He was eloquent and he just knew what to say, how to say it, what tone, and how to present himself. He did such an excellent job that when he was done, everybody stood up and clapped their hands because they were amazed at the way that he taught around Psalm 23. The very next week, another man, a guest speaker came, a preacher, but this preacher wasn't as eloquent and he wasn't as accomplished in public speaking, but he was anointed. And when he preached on Psalm 23, when he was done, people didn't just get up and clap their hands. They started weeping and crying because the presence of God was evident in the room. It's good to be accomplished in public speaking. It's good to be eloquent in preaching. It's good to have all these things. But what we need today in the church is preachers, ministers of the gospel that are filled with the Holy Spirit, that are anointed by the Holy Spirit. Why? Because it's got the power to destroy the works of the enemy. Isaiah chapter 10 verse 27 says, listen to this. It's the enemy's yoke that is destroyed because of the anointing. The anointing destroys the yoke of the enemy. And the anointing will set a person apart. Now, more than being an accomplished public speaker or preacher, I want to be anointed. I want the Holy Spirit to be evident in my ministry so that when people hear me speak, they don't hear me as a man, but they hear God. They hear the voice of the Father. They sense the presence of God. That's what I want. That's what I desire. And that's what we need. And that's what made Jesus so effective in his ministry. But now we see here, Jesus, like I said, has concluded his sermon on the Mount. He was preaching and ministering for 3 chapters long about the kingdom of God. He was preaching around attitude in the kingdom, how to influence people in the world. He even spoke about the law and how he came to fulfill the law. He gave a teaching on prayer, giving, fasting, marriage, the power of words, the law of love, and even how to walk with God and get answers in prayer. It's a powerful sermon with so much topics and so much revelation around the kingdom. Yeah, we see in Matthew how the king is busy teaching us about his kingdom. He's ministering to us about his kingdom. Now Jesus is coming down from the mountain in Matthew chapter 8 verse 1 and the multitudes are following him, the Bible says. And what is he doing? He's coming to now manifest the kingdom. First he taught about the kingdom, but now he's going to manifest the kingdom. He first gave the theory, now he's going to do the practical. And we read what follows in Matthew chapter 8 and 9. We read of 10 miracles that Jesus performed after he preached the Sermon on the Mount. Now I can't help but draw a comparison between Moses in the Old Testament and Jesus in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, Moses was on top of the mountain of God, Exodus chapter 20, and he received 10 commandments, and he came down from the mountain with those 10 commandments, and he gave religion to the people. But now in the New Testament, we see Jesus, the Messiah, coming down from the mountain. And he doesn't have 10 commands. No, he performs 10 miracles. He's manifesting his kingdom here on earth. Now, listen to what Isaiah 35, verse 5 to 6 says, because Jesus actually fulfilled this prophecy. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For water shall burst forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. This is speaking prophetically about the day of the Messiah, when his kingdom shall manifest on earth. And yet Jesus manifests his kingdom, showing that he's got complete power and authority to perform signs, miracles, and wonders. So he wasn't just an accomplished preacher, but there was something so unique, so powerful. There was something so awesome about his ministry because he performed signs, miracles, and wonders. Now, as he's coming down from the mountain, the king needs to manifest his kingdom. So for the first time in the New Testament, he's about to manifest his kingdom after he's preached the Sermon on the Mount. And now he's going to come and he needs to encounter the people at the foot of the mountain. Now, who would you think that Jesus, the Son of God, should manifest his kingdom to? You know, in other words, reveal his kingdom to. Maybe he should do it to a Pharisee. You know, they had a lot of influence and impact in the communities. Maybe he should have done it to a government official. Maybe a government official will come and encounter him. Or maybe a rabbi, or some community leader, or somebody that has got authority in Judea. But no, it's none of those. Who does Jesus encounter, and who does he first reveal his kingdom to? Who does he manifest his kingdom first and foremost to? The Bible says it was a leper. A leper. A leper would almost be an outcast in society in biblical times. The first person Jesus encounters when he comes down from the mountain is an outcast, is a reject, is somebody that has been ostracized, pushed out. Now, let me give context to a leper in biblical times. Leprosy was a disease that was an overwhelming disease, an overpowering disease. It was a disease that if you ever contracted it, it had a big impact on your life in a negative sense. It would literally change your life forever. You can imagine if you are somebody that's healthy, fit, and strong, and all of a sudden you've got this white rash or white mark somewhere on your body. And the law of Moses stated that you had to go and be inspected by the Levitical priest. So now you go and you get inspected, and now you've got to go through a process to make sure that the leprosy is not spreading, or that it's not a severe kind of leprosy. Now you've got to go through a process. There's a time that has to take place, and if it spreads, or if it's discovered that it's a bad kind of leprosy, you would be condemned out of society to go stay in a colony with other lepers. You would be pushed out of society, and maybe you were fit and strong before, but now because of this leprosy, you would lose your job. You would lose contact with your loved ones. If you were a mother, you could not hold your children any longer. You could not embrace your children any longer. If you were a wife, you could not be in intimacy with your husband. You had to be separated from your husband, and vice versa. If you were a husband, you had to be separated from your wife. If you were a father, you could not embrace your family anymore. If you had a business or you were successful in the community, all of a sudden that meant nothing, and you would be pushed out. And leprosy was one of those diseases that you did not immediately die, but it slowly and painfully overtook your body. And little by little, it would numb your nerves. And later, it would even cause your fingers, your toes, body parts to fall off. In fact, it was called the disease that would kill you inch by inch. And some people would have leprosy for up to 25, 30 years before they died. Living outside of the community, living amongst other lepers. Now, if you go and you stay with other lepers, you can imagine the mindset. It's a mindset of defeat and mediocrity. So this didn't just have a physical impact, but it had an emotional impact. It had a psychological impact. It had a social impact. It had a relational impact. It condemned you to poverty for the rest of your life unless you could somehow get healed. Now, leprosy in the Bible was an outward manifestation of an inward sin. So what leprosy in the Bible is to us in the spirit what sin is. It begins small, but it's got huge ramifications. It's got big consequences. And it's for us an indication in the spirit what happens when we allow sin into our lives. So that's the spiritual aspect if we look at leprosy according to the Bible. One of the most painful things that would happen if you ever contracted leprosy was that people had to keep a social distance from you. Now, we don't understand social distancing, but COVID came and taught us a lot about social distancing. And if you had leprosy, if you ever came close to somebody, you were to shout unclean. Or people had to show you out and show that you were unclean. You could not come within 2 meters of a person. And because leprosy was airborne, some people would stay a very far distance from you. So you were treated like a walking disease. And you can imagine how painful that was. Now, the people in the religious community believed that leprosy was actually God's judgment upon a person. And they had actually no mercy towards lepers. In fact, historical records and Bible scholars tell stories of how rabbis would actually brag about how rude they were to a leper when they would go to the synagogue. And it would almost be like a badge of honor because lepers were seen as examples of God's judgment. God was judging them and condemning them. You see, religion is cruel. Now Jesus comes and he encounters this leper, this man that has got this deadly, devastating disease. And what does the leper ask Jesus? Listen to this. Listen to what he says. Verse 2 of Matthew chapter 8. Lord, if you are willing, if you're willing, you can make me clean. If you are willing. In other words, I know you can, but is it your will to heal me? Now, this has been a struggle for so many Christians for centuries. Is it the will of God to heal us? Is it the will of God to heal us of sickness and disease? In fact, I've even heard well-meaning Christians pray, Lord, if it's your will, heal this person. Lord, if it's your will, heal my loved one. Lord, if it's your will, please heal me. And that's what this leper was asking. If you are willing, is it your will? Now, how will you ever know if it's the will of God to do something or not? Well, you've got to read it in the testament. Let's say that you are a child of a very rich and wealthy person, and they've got so many assets and finances and investments and property. And one day this parent of yours dies. How will you ever know what do you inherit? Or what is yours? You would have to get the testament. And whatever is written in black and white in the testament, that belongs to you. That is yours. And by law, it is yours to possess. That's what we call today a testament or a will. Did you know that God has got a testament, a will for his children? What is it? It's his word. Every promise in God's word is yes and amen to those that believe, to those that are willing to possess it, the Bible says. It's theirs. So if I want to know what the will of God is for my life, I got to get into the word of God. The word of God is the will of God. It's his testament. That's why it's divided between Old Testament and New Testament. It is his testament for my life. So if I read of a promise in the word of God regarding an area that I'm struggling in, that is God's will for my life in that area. You know, Paul writes in Romans chapter 12 verse 2, he says, the will of God is pleasing, perfect, and good. It's pleasing, it's not unpleasant. It's perfect, not imperfect. It's good, not bad. Jesus came to give us life and life in abundance, John chapter 10 verse 10. So God wants us to live. God wants us to have life. And in Isaiah chapter 53 verse 5, we read the will of God regarding sickness and disease. Listen to what the Bible says. Isaiah 53 verse 5. I want to quickly get my Bible here. Listen to what Isaiah wrote in the Old Testament speaking about the Messiah. And this is what he said in the Bible. Isaiah 53, verse 4 to 5. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are, past tense, we are healed. Come on, say it out loud. By the stripes of Christ, I'm healed. I'm healed. It's a done deal. So, Pastor, why are not more born again children of God healed? Why are they not walking in the healing? Well, they've not yet got a revelation of the testament, the will of God for their lives. By the stripes of Christ, we are healed. When Jesus died on the cross, he didn't just die so that we can go to heaven. He died so that we can live the abundant life. And you can't live the abundant life if you are sick. Jesus did not die on the cross so that you can be sick. He died on the cross according to Isaiah 53 verse 5, and he bore our sicknesses. So if he bore our sicknesses, why do you want to bear it? He bore our sicknesses for us. Now this leper is asking, if you are willing, is it the will of God? Now, religion condemned him. Religion judged him, the leper. Now Jesus is coming, and what is he going to do? Is he going to judge and condemn this leper like other religious teachers, rabbis? Or is he going to show mercy? You know, the Bible says in John chapter 5 verse 19, Jesus speaking, he says, I don't do anything of myself unless I see the Father do it. In other words, Jesus didn't do anything unless it was the will of God or unless he had permission from God. So whatever Jesus does or how he responds to this leper is going to reveal the Father, the will of the Father. And what does Jesus do? He does something that is quite shocking by biblical standards, especially in those times. And listen to what the Bible says, verse 3. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him. Jesus put out his hand and touched him. The very first miracle in the New Testament, the very first miracle in the Gospels that we read in the Bible, the very first miracle that we are made aware of is the miracle of a leper. Somebody that was condemned by religion, but touched by Jesus. Now, the Bible does say in Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, that Jesus, when he started his ministry, he went around preaching and he performed many signs, miracles, and wonders. But I'm talking about when we read the New Testament from the standpoint of Matthew, we read for the first time this miraculous healing taking place of a leper. A leper, an outcast, a reject. It was almost as if the worst case scenario could ever come and stand before Jesus, and it was a leper. And yet Jesus manifests his kingdom. He manifests the Father. And what was that with? Healing. And he touched him. And he touched him. By touching him, he was actually showing that he's got complete authority and power over sickness and disease. And did you know that Jesus has got complete authority and power over your affliction, over your sickness, over your disease? No matter what's afflicting you in your body, Jesus has got power over that. And he manifested that in the gospel. What religion forbid, Jesus touched. And there was so much power in that one touch that he was able to manifest immediately healing. Immediately. And I love what Jesus said. He said, I am willing. I am willing. I want to. In the Gospel of Mark chapter 1 verse 41, the Bible says that Jesus was even moved with compassion to this leper. He had a compassion for him. He had a love for him. Do you know, God the Father has got compassion towards us as his children. So I don't know what you're struggling with. High blood pressure, diabetes. Maybe you're struggling with some chronic illness or an autoimmune disease. Whatever it is, God has got compassion towards you. And he loves you. And maybe you feel like you're an outcast and you feel like you're a reject. And maybe you can even put yourself in the shoes of this leper. God doesn't see you as so. He wants to touch you. And you know, one touch from God can do more than 1,000 sermons. One touch from God can do more than 1,000 sermons. You know, it was one touch that changed the woman with the issue of blood. It changed her life. Mark chapter 5 verse 28, she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, if I could just get into contact with Jesus, my life will be changed. And she touched the hem of his garment. And the Bible says she was healed immediately of her affliction. You know what a lot of us need? We need a touch from God. We need a touch from heaven. This man, this leper, received a touch from Jesus. And immediately, the Bible says, his leprosy was cleansed. Wow, powerful. You know, a touch from God changed Jacob into Israel. In Genesis chapter 32, Jacob wrestled with God and he refused to let go of God until God blessed him. And you know, sometimes we got to get into that place where we say, you know what, I'm going to pray until I see a manifestation. I'm going to fast until I see my breakthrough. I'm going to seek you, Lord. I'm going to spend time in your word. I'm going to worship. Lord, I'm going to do whatever I can, but what I want is a touch. I want a touch from God. I've put my trust long enough in men. I've put my trust long enough in what people say or what people promise. I've done it for far too long. Lord, I need you now. You know, that's a powerful place to be. When you get to a place where you say, you know what? I just need to be touched by God. I just need God to move in my life. And this leper crying out to Jesus is a picture of prayer, of how a believer, how a child of God, who's afflicted, oppressed, struggling, can call out to a compassionate and loving Savior. And Jesus had compassion towards the leper. But notice the Bible says, and listen to this, the Bible says, I want to just backtrack a little bit. Verse 2, the leper came and worshipped him. Worshipped him. Now, you know, today we have diluted worship, the concept of worship in the church. Worship has now been diluted to the point where, oh, it's a part of a service. For example, we say, when we started the service, we first sang fast praise songs and then we sang slow worship songs. Or we say that was the worship. The music was the worship. Now, worship is far more than just music or the beat of a song or the speed of a song or the tempo of a song. Worship is far more than that. Worship is a lifestyle. You know, we've even got to the point where we even say that certain people are called to worship. Oh, he or she's a worshiper. They are worshippers. I'm not a worshiper like him. I'm not a worshiper like her. Well, if that was true, then this man, he should have had, to worship Jesus, he should have had an instrument, or he should have had an inclination as a musician, or he should have had the ability to sing or play some musical instrument if he ever wanted to worship Jesus. But we don't read that. The Bible says he came and he worshiped Jesus. And how did he worship Jesus? By kneeling before Jesus. The Bible says he kneeled before Jesus. Kneeling is actually a manifestation of humility and surrender. Humility meaning that it's not about me, it's all about you. And surrender saying, Lord, I need you and I'm nothing without you. You know, James chapter 4 verse 6 says, God gives grace to the humble. Those that walk in humility receive grace from God. Receive grace from God. And the second thing he did was he called out Lord. Lord, powerful. Powerful title. You know what Lord is? Master. And you know what I've come to realize? A lot of us want Jesus to save us and take us to heaven. We want him to be our savior, but not our Lord. Because we still want to be the director, the CEO of our lives, so to speak. But if he's going to be Lord, he's going to be Lord of all, of everything. That means you've got to completely surrender to Jesus. And this leper worshiped Jesus by kneeling and crying out, Lord. And the Bible says that was worship. Now, that kind of worship would show up a lot of Christians in the church today. Because unless we feel like worshiping, or unless the music moves us, or unless we've got a reason to, or we've got a testimony, or we've received some breakthrough, then we'll worship God. But this man had been condemned by society, an outcast. He had been living in poverty. His life had been devastated by disease. And what is he doing? He's worshiping. He's worshiping. That's the heart of a worshiper. A worshiper is somebody that can glorify God in spite of everything that's taking place in their lives. A worshiper is somebody that can praise God in spite of the pain, suffering, or the torment that they might be going through. You would think that he'd worship Jesus after he received his healing. No, he worshiped Jesus before. And let me tell you something. I believe his worship actually gave Jesus an opportunity to move in his life. Because if he came there prideful with an attitude, guess what? I do believe that God would have opposed him. Jesus would have opposed him because the Bible says in James chapter 4 verse 6, that same verse I mentioned just now, God resists the proud. So oftentimes our miracle is lying in our worship. Your breakthrough is lying in your praise. If you are just willing to worship God, praise God, in spite of what you're feeling, what symptom you might have, what you're going through, you will see your breakthrough. Psalm 150 verse 6 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. What's the qualification for worship? You need to have breath. Not the right atmosphere. It's good to have a good atmosphere to worship God in a church setting, but you don't always have to wait for the right atmosphere or the right song or the right feel. No, you can worship God. If you've got breath, you can worship God. And worshiping God is calling out to Him and making Him master of all. Realizing that you are the creation and He's the creator. Realizing that we are nothing but sinful outside of Christ and He is our Savior. We got to recognize who He is. And this leper came with humility, in surrender, calling Him Lord. And it moved the heart of Jesus so much so that Jesus touched him. Jesus touched him. And listen to what Jesus said. Listen to this. And Jesus said to him, verse 4, "See that you tell no one, but go your way and show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them." Now the Bible tells us in verse 5 that Jesus had entered Capernaum. And as he entered Capernaum, who approaches him now? Who's the next person that he can reveal his kingdom to? Who's the next person that he can manifest his kingdom to? A Pharisee? A rabbi? A government official? A community leader? No, another outcast. A centurion. Now let me quickly give you background. Centurions were Roman officials that would actually be scattered right throughout the Roman Empire in different communities and provinces. And these Roman officials, these centurions, they were basically in charge of 100 soldiers. So there were 100 men that followed them and listened to their command. Now, centurions in the biblical times were highly respected, highly revered. They were people of influence. They were people that had finances and wealth and status. But to the Jews, they were outcasts because they were heathens. They were seen as heathens. And now this heathen approaches this Jewish rabbi. And the Bible says he comes to him in desperation, pleading to him. And listen to what he says, verse 6. "Lord, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." Now, some Bible scholars actually believe, and I can imagine this, that this servant that he's speaking about was not actually a servant, but his son, his child. However it be, this person that was tormented and sick meant a lot to this centurion. And for this centurion to come to this Jewish rabbi and have everybody notice that he's approaching this Jewish rabbi would have actually been quite humiliating. But he was willing to be humiliated because he was desperate. And I wonder if we are desperate enough to see the breakthrough that God has got in store for us. I wonder if we are desperate enough to see God move in our lives. I've noticed where there's desperation, God moves. And yeah, he comes and he says, "Please, my servant is lying at home, paralyzed and dreadfully tormented." And notice the response of Jesus. "I will come and heal him." You know, you can never find in the Gospels, you can never find it, where Jesus ever rejected anyone who was sick or diseased. You could never find that he rejected them and refused to heal them. It's not in the Gospels. In fact, any person that approached Jesus, Jesus was willing to heal them and deliver them. And listen to what the centurion says to him. Jesus, after Jesus said he will come and heal him. Verse 8, "And the centurion answered and said, 'Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof.'" Okay? "But only speak a word and my servant will be healed." Just speak a word. You don't have to come and visit me. You don't have to come under my roof. But if you could just give me a word. What I need is a word. What I need is prophecy. What I need is the Father's voice over my situation. Just speak the word. There's so much healing and power in the word. Now, notice, he wasn't dependent upon the fact that Jesus had to come and lay hands upon his servant. He wasn't expecting Jesus to come and pay a visit. He just needed a word. And you know, this really struck me this week because I've seen how many precious children of God, and I'm speaking about myself, will go to revival meetings. And they will hear that there are miracles taking place in the revival meetings, or they'll go to a healing service, or they will go to a conference, and the gifts of God are moving and healing is manifesting. And then they'll go to the front of the church or in front of the auditorium, and they are hoping that if somebody could just lay hands on them, that they'll be healed of the sickness or disease or the affliction that they have in their body. Now they go. They're waiting for a manifestation of healing. They get prayed for, but there is no manifestation. And I've seen this happen over and over and over again. I've seen how maybe out of 100 people that are afflicted and diseased that come to church trusting God for healing, maybe 5-10 out of 100 receive a miracle of healing on the spot. But the other 90, it's as if it just didn't happen for them. Now, why would that happen? Is it because God doesn't want to heal them and he wants to heal the others? Or because God likes those 10, but he doesn't like the other 90? No, no. God is not a respecter of persons. Every case, every individual is different. For some, God manifests a miracle because that's what he wants to do in that person's life at that moment. For another person, there's a process of healing that must take place. A good example is 2 Kings chapter 5. We see how Naaman wanted to receive a touch from the man of God. And the man of God didn't do what he wanted. And he got upset. And he turned away. The man of God gave him a word. Not a touch, a word. And he had to walk out the word in obedience to see his breakthrough. Now, I've come to tell somebody today, just because you did not receive the miracle you expected or it didn't manifest the way you wanted, doesn't mean that it's not God's will to heal you. You got to walk out the word of God until you see the breakthrough take place, until you see the healing manifest. I believe miracles can take place. I've seen miracles take place. I've stood in the casualty in our local hospital and I prayed for people that were sick. I prayed for a man who had cancer and it didn't look like he was going to live. And he was healed of that cancer. I prayed for him and I saw how God touched him. He even came to our church and he testified about how I prayed for him and God, through my prayer, using me as a vessel, wasn't me, but through me, healed him of cancer. And he lived a couple more years. I've seen that manifestation. I've seen it happen in revival meetings. I've seen how I can pray for somebody and a miracle takes place. Then I've seen other cases where it does not happen immediately. And people get despondent. Why? Because I believe one or two things. Sometimes they put in their trust, their faith in that prophet, or that pastor, or that evangelist. Or God actually wants them to walk out a process of obedience. Like Naaman, you've got to walk out the process of obedience. You've got to walk out the word of God. Now listen to what God says in Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what's right in his sight and give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases on you which I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. What God is saying in his word, if you could just do what I say, if you could obey me, if you could walk out my word, you will see a manifestation of healing upon your life. Listen to what Proverbs chapter 4 verse 20 to 22 says. Listen to this. My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. In other words, listen to what God says. Do not let them depart from your eyes, but keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to all their flesh. God's word is health to all our flesh. In the Hebrew, Proverbs chapter 4 verse 22, the word health is translated as medicine. In other words, you could say that God's word is medicine for our bodies. Is medicine. So what am I saying tonight? Sometimes you get a manifestation, and sometimes God gives you his word. The centurion came and said, just give me a word. Just give me a word. You don't have to lay hands. You don't have to manifest a miracle. Just give me a word. And you know, I have seen it in my own life, how as I walk out the word, as I feed myself with the word of God, as I live in the word of God, Matthew chapter 4 verse 4, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. As I build up my faith with God's word, Romans chapter 10 verse 17, I begin to see and experience the breakthrough. Just give me a word. You know, God's word is so powerful. You might not have an apostle or an evangelist or prophet to pray for you right now, but you've got the word of God. And God's word is powerful. It's something that you've got with you every single day. Every single day. You know, a lot of people just get the wrong doctrine. They listen to the wrong teachers. They listen to the wrong people that actually speak in the negative. They don't build their faith. They build their fears. There's actually some preachers that preach that it's not God's will to heal everyone. That not everybody's going to ever be healed. But, you know, as I read the Bible and I read what Jesus did, and Jesus came to reveal the Father, John chapter 5 verse 19, I realize it's the will of God to heal me. To heal me. Some people might argue and say, okay, yeah, but what about the thorn in Paul's flesh? Well, that was something to keep him humble. That was something that was there to keep him humble and manifest the grace of God in his life. It wasn't a disease or sickness. It was a messenger sent to buffet Paul. Buffet means they came and oppressed or abused Paul. So people say, yeah, but the thorn in his flesh, why didn't God heal him? Well, God was manifesting his grace, but he wasn't sickly and dying. No, he wasn't. And we've all got a thorn in our flesh. We've all got something that we are contending with, but we've got to be so careful that we don't take the Bible out of context. It's dangerous to do so. It's dangerous to take the Bible out of context. In fact, I want to go there, 2 Corinthians, and I want to read it. And I want to show you that it wasn't a sickness. Listen to this. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 to 9, speaking about the thorn in the flesh, which a lot of preachers, a lot of people use as, you know, they use this to try and say that it's not God's will to heal everyone. But you've got to read the Bible and take it literal. Listen to this. And lest I should be exalted above measure through abundance of revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. And what's the thorn in the flesh? A sickness or disease? No. The messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord three times, that it might depart from me. In other words, he prayed three times, Lord, take away this thorn in my flesh. Take away this thing that's causing me humiliation. And we don't know exactly what it is. But listen to verse 9. And he, God, said unto me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I will rather glory in my infirmities than the power of Christ, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. In other words, I will rather glory in the weaknesses I've got. My weaknesses, my shortcomings are an opportunity for God to move in my life. Child of God, God wants to heal you. He's got many avenues of healing, but it's the same destination. Just because it did not happen doesn't mean that it will not happen. I remember years ago, there was a lady in our church. She really blessed me with her testimony. She said, that she was studying the Bible around the area of healing. And she was going through a struggle because she was struggling to fall pregnant. And she was really trusting God to heal her of a condition that was preventing her from being pregnant. And her pastor back then was a spirit-filled pastor in a Pentecostal church. And this spirit-filled pastor actually gave her a challenge to every single day declare God's word, declare God's healing, healing scriptures over her life. And she was to do it constantly. And the pastor would follow up with her and say, did you declare your scriptures today? Did you declare it over your life? Did you declare it over your body? And there were some days she would be despondent, and without fail, that pastor would call, and that pastor would say, you've got to declare health. You've got to declare God's word. Why? Because God's word is medicine. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 22. God's word is medicine. And when she seemed not to get any better, the pastor said, okay, you've got to up the dosage like you would take antibiotics. And if the infection got more severe or the fever got more severe, we up the dose. So we're going to do it with the word of God. Now the pastor was challenging her to do it three times a day, to declare the word and to speak the word. Do you know, eventually that woman was healed, not just healed, but she fell pregnant and gave birth to a child. And that child is today in her 20s. You know how that blessed me? Because it made me realize the power of God's word. The power of God's word. Do you know God says in Psalm 119 verse 89 that his word is established forever. Nothing and nobody can ever change his word. Psalm 119 verse 89. Psalm 138 verse 2. God magnifies his word above his name. God places his word above himself. That's how powerful God's word is. And the centurion that came to Jesus said to Jesus, I'm a man of authority. And I say to one man, go, and he goes. And I say to one man, come, and he comes. Just speak the word and it will happen. There'll be healing. You see, the centurion, although he was a heathen, understood authority. And he understood that Jesus had spiritual authority. You see, because centurions in biblical times were actually representatives, ambassadors of Caesar. And there was no one more powerful in all of the earth from man's perspective than Caesar, the emperor of Rome. But Caesar delegated his authority throughout the Roman Empire, and centurions were given that authority. And when a centurion spoke, it was seen as Caesar speaking. He would speak on behalf of Caesar. And whatever authority Caesar had, the centurion had. Now he comes to Jesus and he says, I notice you've got authority. That's what he says. That's how I paraphrase it. I notice. Verse 9, for I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it. I've got authority. You see, he recognized the authority of the word of Jesus. Because his word had authority in the natural, he recognized that Jesus' word had authority in the spiritual. You know, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 27, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Me and the Father are equal. We are equal. And the Roman centurion recognized the spiritual authority. And that produced healing. I want to ask you, do you recognize the authority of God's word, the power of God's word? Do you know, there's so many people, they think that this is just a book. This for me is not just a book. This is Jesus in print. This is a manifestation of Jesus. The Bible says in John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And John chapter 1 verse 14, I want to read this. Listen to this. And the Word became human, and he made his home amongst us, and he was full of unfailing love and faithfulness. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. Jesus is the Word of God manifest. Do you know God says in Isaiah 55 verse 11, my word will go out of my mouth and not return void. Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 12, I watch over my word to perform it. So start with God's word. Put your trust in God, not in man. Can people pray for you and you receive healing? Yes. But your faith should not be in them or their prayer. It should be in God. And God can use them as an instrument. But the minute you put your trust in man, God is a jealous God. He's not going to share his glory. And God is not going to base your testimony upon somebody else's doing. So now you went to somebody, they prayed for you, they lay hands on you. Now you go around saying, oh, that person healed me. No, God's not going to do that. God will not share his glory. The minute we lose focus, God's going to have to take us through a process where we get back to him and realize it's all because of him. So don't be despondent tonight. In fact, feed upon the word of God. Start listening to the word of God. Remember, that's what Proverbs chapter 4 verse 20 to 22 says. My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. To incline your ear to God's sayings means that you decline it to everyone else and you focus only on God. Do not let them depart from your eyes, but keep them in the midst of your heart. In other words, my word must be your priority, for they are life to those who find them and health to all their flesh. I leave you with that thought tonight. Come, let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you for the privilege and opportunity I have to share the word of God with your children. I pray, Lord, for those that maybe are despondent because they've not seen a manifestation of healing. Lord, that you, Lord Father God, would let this word speak and minister to their hearts. And I pray, Lord, give them a prophetic insight to the situation and circumstance that they are in, that they may know what is the word of God, the will of God in this season, in this moment. Thank you, Lord Father God, that we've got revelation from your word to understand what we need to do, how we need to navigate life. And when things don't work out the way we expected, thank you, Lord, that your word is still true. I pray right now for every person that's struggling in their health, Lord, that you would touch their mortal bodies, that you would quicken healing unto them, and that they will have a testimony for the glory of God, not for the glory of man. I pray, Lord, bless each and every person tonight with a good night's rest and a blessed week to come. We give you all the glory and honor. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I want to leave you with this thought. Listen to what Matthew chapter 8 verse 13 says. And I'm going to leave you with this thought tonight because that's actually how I should have concluded this. And listen to what Jesus says regarding this man that just wanted a word. Just wanted a word. All he wanted was a word so that healing could manifest. And listen to what Jesus said. Matthew chapter 8 verse 13. Listen to this. And Jesus said unto the centurion, go your way. As you have believed, so it be done unto you. And his servant was healed from that same hour. As you have believed, let it be done. Where's your faith? In man or in God? If you're disappointed because it did not work out with man, then maybe that's an indication you need to shift your focus back to God. God bless you. I want to quickly greet everybody that's online. I want to say welcome to Mundi Meyer. It's good to have you online. God bless you. Yolani Buerta, I trust that you are well. I trust that Michael is doing well and that baby Alex is doing well. 1 year old this week or this last week. God bless you, Yolani. Mundi, I trust that you're doing well and I trust that this word spoke to you. I trust that Leon is doing well. God bless you. Pastor Yolanda van Vieren, it's good to have you online. Thank you, Pastor Yolanda, for watching. Thank you, Pastor Marita Kotze, for watching. God bless you, Pastor Marita. Gerda Brainette, it's good to have you online. God bless you. Salome Filloon, it's good to have you online. God bless you, Salome. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch. Cynthia Haasbroek, Westbroek, not Haasbroek, Cynthia Westbroek. Yes, I'll intercede for you, Cynthia. She says, I've got a serious condition with my knee. I can't walk. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for touching Cynthia's knee right now. I rebuke and renounce in the name of Jesus this affliction, this condition upon her body in Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord, for divine healing that's manifesting right now in Cynthia's body in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, Cynthia. Henry Bridger, it's good to have you online. Trudy De Beer, welcome. Marie Wilder, it's good to have you online. God bless you. Amen. Joey Olifier, it's good to have you online. God bless you. Renee Grace, it's good to have you online. Well, thank you to all of you that have taken the time to watch. Well, it's been a joy to share the Word of God with you. 1 hour went by so quickly. I didn't actually realize that I was just enjoying ministering the Word of God. But thank you to all of you who comment, like, and share. I appreciate each and every one of you. May you have a blessed week to come. May God's grace and mercy surround you like a shield. And may God's face shine down upon you and your family. This is Pastor Dominique signing out.